Good morning, everyone. We're going to get started. Without wasting any time, here to talk about cybersecurity tips, tools, and techniques, please welcome Ron Woerner.
Thank you all very much. Welcome to RSA 2020. You all ready to party? Woo! I mean, this is the start. Actually, yesterday was the start of a really busy week. We have the best minds in cybersecurity here in San Francisco this week. I am honored to be one of the first ones to kick it all off with my cybersecurity tips, tools, and techniques. How many of you have seen this presentation in the past? So a handful. I do update it every year. You're going to find some tools that are still there, mainly because they're rock solid. They've just been part of our staple of tools. If you have the app, pull it up. You can use it to take notes. I made sure the presentation I'm using right now has been uploaded to it, because this is one of those talks which I'm constantly updating, bringing in new tools as I'm finding new things. So use the app, the real value. So please don't go running out of the room after I say this. The real value is not necessarily me up here. The real value is the slide deck. See, I'm a collector. I collect things in lists. I've always liked lists. And what this is just my list of stuff I keep on my cybersecurity thumb drive. So this is who I am. You can see what I do. Please Google stalk me. Check out my TED Talk, Hackers Wanted, How We Need to Be Building the Next Generation of Hackers. Waiting for the picture. There we go. You can Google stalk me. This is like my 18th year speaking at RSA. I just really dig it. The links, actually, they might even be as updated as the last couple of weeks. I noticed the one this morning as I was going through, the link had changed. So use the links at your own risk, okay? What's one of the key sayings of cybersecurity? Trust, but think you should do that with what I'm providing you? No, no, no. If you see a link, it's okay, just click on it. I mean, we heard that in the keynote, right? So no, double check all of it. Let's see, so what are we doing here, going back? I teach high schoolers, I teach college, university, at the undergrad and graduate, and I like to share these tips, tools, and techniques with my students and with y'all. I do need to warn you on something, though. I've already given you this heads up. I am a college professor. I give homework. I like to depress the high school students I work with, and I say homework begins after you graduate. So y'all got homework. Now, I have to admit, I confused my speaker manager here at RSA, because you noticed on the talks, you'll find this apply slide at the end. She's like, Ron, your apply slide's at the beginning. I'm like, yeah, I know, I did that on purpose. Stephen Covey, begin with the end in mind. So this is what's on the test, by the way. I'm gonna be going through a whole load of tools. Find a few gold nuggets, okay? Play with them, try them out, test them in your own test environment. Learn about them, experiment, be a hacker with them. Do that within the next week. I mean, this week is crazy, so do it next week. Pull out this slide deck. Again, in what, 3-6 months, find some other tools or tips that you haven't been familiar with. I almost can guarantee you're gonna find something you did not know, just because there is so much more to know. So this is the final exam. Please, if you hear of a tool or know of a tip I did not cover, contact me through LinkedIn, Twitter, email, whatever. Let me know about your tool. I have 60 slides to cover in about 50 minutes. I usually don't have a lot of time for Q&A. If we do, that'll be great. If not, please, we'll take it offline. We keep this going. So first, some basics. My daughter likes to call me Captain Obvious. Anyone else? Yeah. If you only remember one slide from this is my Lord of the Rings slide, the one slide to rule them all. I have a few, actually, slides like this. First of all, free advice on cybersecurity. If anyone else have an Aunt Sally or Uncle Joe in your life, you know that person that comes up to you and says, Richard, can you help me fix my computer? Anyone else with that Aunt Sally or Uncle Joe? Yeah, we all have that person. So I'll send my mom, 87-year-old, living in rural Michigan, to like stay safe online or stop, think, connect. Free resources from your United States government, Department of Homeland Security, and the National Cybersecurity Alliance. So what is the number one hacking tool? Google. Google is the internet's vacuum cleaner, sucking up information from all over. First skill you all need to have, Google hacking, right? Do you know how to use the advanced search from the actual search bar? I mean, you can go into the advanced search right here, but do it from the search bar. Like if you're looking for information on a particular site, you use site colon, and then you add the site. If you're looking for PDFs, do use file type colon PDF or PowerPoint, Word document, Excel spreadsheets. And this is a fun one, LMGTFY. Let me Google that for you. I use this one with my students all the time. So this one's fun. What they do is it just pulled together a lot of different search engines. I do use Bing on occasion, and people are going, what? Why do I use Bing if I'm searching for things on Microsoft or anything Microsoft specific? I am very tool agnostic. I see all of these as tools. I am a professor, and I'm an independent consultant, so I'm not beholden to any particular vendor, okay? If I'm talking about a particular vendor's product, it's because, again, I'm a fanboy. I use it as a practitioner. I love lists, as I mentioned. From here on out in the presentation, I'm going to be bumping back and forth really quick between the slide deck and Brave. Oh, yes, before, so this is not in the slide deck. Congratulations, because you decided to show up live, you get one extra tip. Go to humblebundle.com, pull up the cybersecurity books. For $20, and part of that goes to charity, you get some of the top books in cybersecurity, like from Bruce Schneier, Chris Hadnagy, Adam Shostak. Sorry, and I'm making the poor person who's trying to take my picture. Tribe of Hackers just got inducted into the cybersecurity canon. The social engineering books. Again, I'm not associated with this, but when my students are asking me what books should I read, bingo, right there. Okay, now back to our regularly scheduled program. Lists, lists, lists. Let's make this big. Sectools.org is another one of these Lord of the Rings sites if you have one site to go to. It's been around forever by Fyodor. Top 100 cybersecurity tools. And again, I will make the slide deck available through my GitHub so you don't always have to take pictures of a lot of these. So a lot of these tools I'll be talking about. So from Wireshark, Metasploit, Nessus, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Pure List is where I blog. They have their own list of ultimate, I don't know if it's the ultimate list, but it's a damn good list. From Burp Suite, DSniff, oldies but goodies. By the way, I go really fast, so hopefully you all can stay caught up. Anyway. Most popular from Kitploit. More lists. I'm just going to jump ahead. Complete penetration testing and hacking tools. Because say you have a particular job. So here's what I'm going to challenge you to do with all of these different lists. First, define what the problem is you want to solve. And then ask, is there a tool already created for it? Most likely there is. Rather than taking the time for you to create your own tool, go out there, ask the community. That's why a community like we have here at RSA, your local communities like ISSA, ISC squared, ISACA, go to them and say, hey, I'm looking for a tool to do this. Can you help me? And quite possibly one of your friends may have it. Art of Hacker on GitHub, I should. More lists from PeerList. Again, I'm a big fan of PeerList. From the Frugal Hacker, Hacking Shoestring Budget. Ooh, the origin of this talk. I actually started delivering this talk back in like 2001, 2002, because I'm cheap. Anyone else cheap here? Who here likes free stuff? Yeah, exactly. You go down to the vendor's floor. I have always worked for small, medium enterprises or government enterprises, and they don't always have a large budget. So it's how do we do this at a very low cost point? And that's why cybersecurity on a lean budget is so important. That's why I like the frugal hackers idea of what free tools. So a lot of the tools that I'm going to talk about are free or open source today. If there are any that may have a paid for version associated with it, I try to alert you for it. Some of these tools are for personal use, not for business use. It's up to you. Check the licensing agreement, whether you can use it within your business or not. Cheat sheets. Oh, I didn't even pull all of these up. Anyone else like cheat sheets? I'm a college professor and I like cheat sheets. Peerlist has theirs. Lenny Zeltzer, if you see Lenny walking around here, he's a really quiet guy, but super smart, created his own list of cheat sheets. He's an expert in malware reverse engineering, but he also has cheat sheets on how to write, how to not suck in cybersecurity, how to write pen testing reports. Check out his sheets. OWASP. Tanya Jenka, she hacks purple. Follow her on Twitter. Very involved with OWASP, has their cheat sheets for application security and DevSec. Ooh, I need to ask this question. Anyone playing conference buzzword bingo? You know, you get one of those bingo cards that has like AI, ML, Sims, Elk, LAMP. You know, and if you get the row, you win the bingo prize? Okay. So I try to get as many as I can, but no, OWASP, another great list of cheat sheets. Go back to this. I love the National Institute of Standards and Technology, and they drive me nuts all at the same time. The good news is they are providing free standards across the United States. That is their role. They've been tasked by the US Congress to provide direction for small, medium businesses. Woo-hoo! Downside is, I think they get paid by the word. Their documents tend to be very wordy. And they kind of need to be in that standard business. So take it with a grain of salt. Keep this on your list, though. Their Computer Security Resource Center for their special publications. How many are there now? Like 150 of them, from very technical on encryption to Bluetooth security, IoT security. List goes on. The Center for Internet Security, cisecurity.org. cisecurity.org has their top 20 critical security controls. If you're a small or medium business, make sure you pull this up. Top 20 things you need to do. It starts with asset inventory. Do you know where your stuff is? What's kind of cool, too, is if you have a particular infrastructure you need to secure, whether it's Oracle or Windows Server or it's a Linux variant, they give you lists and directions on how to lock it down, how to secure those systems. Not only operating systems, but applications as well. They provide their self-assessment tool. Now, they do have a lot of paid-for versions as well, like with the benchmarking, but a lot of the benchmarks they give away just to help the community. The last one is associated with the U.S. Department of Defense. Do we have any DOD folks or federal folks here? So a few. Good. So for the rest of you, this is a free resource, again, paid for by the U.S. government. A STIG, Security Technical Implementation Guide, are the lockdown guides, again, for different types of operating systems and major applications. So to STIG something means to secure it. If some security guy from the DOD says you got to STIG it. Just don't STIG a live system. That means you're going to probably brick it. So, great free resources if you're not familiar with it. Anyone from K through 12 here? Occasionally I have a few. Okay, so I need to have a quick tangent. U.S. schools are in trouble. They don't have enough people to help lock down their systems, and they keep running into trouble. My local school district got hit with ransomware a year ago, and it was not pretty. So I provide this list of resources to help them out. But also for any of you, even though this says for K through 12, if you're in a small or medium business. So how many of you are in a small or medium business? A bunch of you. So if you are, you can use these tools. Because whether it's a school district or SMB, another list of how to secure. Firefox, you know, have I been pwned? Consumer Reports, protecting your privacy, etc. Computer US Cert, cybersecurity tips. Every organization should go through some type of a security awareness training, but like as Wendy said, we need to make security as simple as a spoon, right? That was really clever. Why do we have security awareness? For two reasons. One is for compliance. We need to prove to the auditors that everyone in here has been blessed by security awareness. The other reason, though, is actually more important. It's to encourage the right behavior. And that's where these different types of training resources come in. This is just a partial list, by the way, that I maintain of different places you can go to find some free security awareness tools. This is another good one. And I kind of jump around in this slide deck a little bit. It's hard to always have a great flow. Have you ever gone, and I just actually had a client as we're coming over here. You know, we need a better remote patching tool. What tools are out there for remote patching? Go to Captura.com. Let me actually show you this live demo, which is always fun. Actually, if I do this without my glasses. More or less, oh, Art of Hacker, there we go. That's Stig, Cybersecurity, here we go, Captura. So what I did with this is I just typed in the search bar for patch management software, just as an example. What Captura is just a nice list, community run, so crowdsourced, of many different tools in the space. Again, let the buyer beware, you have to do your own homework on each of them, but this gives you an idea of possibly where to start and how to narrow that playing field as to which tools could potentially solve the problem with patch management. I'm actually going to pull up some tools later on that are also open source. But you can see all the different ones that are now available. So this way you can ask better questions of your vendors. And yes, hold your vendors accountable for this. How many of you have used Captura in the past? Okay, so the rest of you, hopefully you now have this little nugget of something that you can use when you're looking for a particular product. And as far as I'm aware, Captura does stay vendor neutral. They are just the repository of information. So just kind of like Amazon with the star system, you can do your own homework with it. The MITRE ATT&CK framework. There are presentations just on the MITRE ATT&CK framework alone. This is kind of a fun list to begin to work through. Let me pull it up. You can see, let me make this big. This is just a laundry list from MITRE of many different types of attacks. So for example, let's look at clipboard data. How is clipboard data, it's a collection, how can it be maliciously used? Well, adversaries may collect data stored in the Windows clipboard from users copying. Procedure example, Agent Tesla can steal it, Dark Comet, JRAT, etc. So this tells you not only how the threat occurs, but potential mitigations and detection, and then laundry list of resources. Threat analysis should be on everybody's radar. How are you going to handle the different types of threats? How do you associate it with the different types of risks? I like the MITRE ATT&CK framework because it gives good just data on how to protect against it. And I think there's a booth actually down on the floor where they spend a lot more time talking about it. But go in and just begin clicking around and playing with it. It's attack.mitre.org. At this point, I'm going to talk to you kind of a switching a little bit, creating a test lab. I'm in the process of actually writing a white paper on this. How many of you have your own test lab at home, whether it's through virtual or other systems? Good. This is one of the top tips I give to those trying to break into cybersecurity. Set up your own home lab to experiment, break things, because when you break it, you learn how to fix it. Numerous free tools available from the Oracle VMbox, VirtualBox, VMware Workstation, Windows 10 with Hyper-V, Parallels. Go out to Lifehacker, you can learn how to set one up. Put on a Linux distribution. Also a great way to go surfing on the internet, and if something bad happens, it's not a big deal. Do we have any other Linux geeks in the room? Cool, good. What I've found fascinating is the convergence of Linux and the Microsoft environment. I'm going to show you that here in a minute, but knowing which distribution. And a fun debate to have with someone, so you find your Linux buddy, and you ask, what flavor do you run? And you go, oh, no, you need to run something else. You know, you're running Fedora? No, you need to run Debian instead. You know, something like that. And that usually gets them on their own little soapbox. Or even better yet, just say, yeah, you'd rather run Windows than Linux. No. You can go out to these different sites. Let me pull up DistroWatch. Oh, this is the how-to geek, or sorry, the life hacker on how to set up a virtual machine. I really dig life hacker. This is the DistroWatch list of Linux builds. Linux Mint is a really good one to start off with. I'm really half tempted to move my mom to Linux Mint. That way she'll stop getting into trouble. IP Fire I've not played around with. Where's our tech person? He's switched. Can you switch back to my laptop? Thank you for that, by the way. It switched off of my laptop for some reason. So I need to tell you something. What always happens whenever you try to do things live is that technology will fail you, right? And that's what we always tend to see. Let's see. There we go. Sorry about that. Technical difficulties. There we go. Now I'm on DistroWatch. Linux Mint, I was talking about IP Fire. This shows on the side many different variants of Linux. So if you're wondering which ones you should experiment with, practice on with your own home lab, you can check out DistroWatch. FOSS has some really good cheat sheets, as I mentioned, on how to run Linux from a command prompt. And the best Linux distros, I wouldn't tell you which one is the best. But just different ones you can use. Who here runs Nmap at home? Okay. Have you ever found, I'll look to the people in the back, have you ever found your neighbors using your home Wi-Fi? It happens. Or all the IoT that your kids are putting on your network, right? So I do recommend running Nmap at home. Zenmap is the Windows GUI equivalent, to be able to see and map out your network. Nmap has been around for, what, 20, 25 years? Occasionally, someone will give me the feedback from this, you know, why are you still talking about Nmap? It's so old. Well, guess what? It's an oldie but a goodie. It still does the job, right? Still tells us what's on our network. If you are running on a mobile device, there's an equivalent called Fing, F-I-N-G. I was half tempted to try it here, but yeah, I'd try not to get in trouble, at least until after I'm done speaking. It's like Nmap, though. It'll tell you other devices on the network and what ports it has open. And then it'll try to give you an indication of what type of a system it is. So you can find all of your neighbors, you know, other iDevices. Anyone here ever use Fing? So a few, good. Jumping a little bit to Qualys. And I'm just showing Qualys not for any other reason, it's because their tool is still rather cool. Let's see, there we go. So I went and I used their test your browser. I've also used the SSL Labs tool to be able to see encryption off of different websites when I've been doing PCI audits. Shows you the level of encryption. So I'm happen to be using Brave. I'm actually trying it out this year. And it tells me the encryption level that I'm running with my browser. So use this with your family and friends to make sure they are using a safe and secure browser. Because again, we can get into religious wars on whether we are using Chrome, Firefox, Brave, hopefully not Internet Explorer. but occasionally, or even the latest edge. This is always a fun conversation. So if you're wondering for what I should do to start a conversation with your neighbors as you're trying to get to know them, ask them what VPN they run. And again, you'll hear a lot of different variants. With the death of net neutrality, we all need to be running a VPN of some type. If you're using the free Wi-Fi here, well, free, of course, is not exactly free. There's always a possible price you may pay, and if you're trying to use the free Wi-Fi without a VPN, then obnoxious hackers like me may be watching what you're doing. So run a VPN. By the way, the one I run is not actually on this list, so go figure. If you want to roll your own, I provide some instructions. You don't actually need to pay for someone else to do a VPN service for you. You can begin to create some of your own. What I like with a VPN is that you can end up being in multiple places at one time. Like you can use it to get past proxies. Or with GDPR, I can't read my local news. So when I was traveling to Europe last year trying to see what's happening at home, it got all blocked. So I used my VPN, made it look like I was coming from somewhere here in the States. DNS. Are you just using your default IP server? Internet service provider for their DNS. There's numerous different ones. Many of the vendors out here on the floor provide free DNS lookups from Google, Cloudflare, Cisco, VeriSign. And what I actually will do about once every month or two is switch. Because if you think about it, your DNS provider, they could be capturing where you're going with just the lookups. They just see where you want to go on the internet. They may be pulling that data, or not. Some of these do have good privacy policies. Again, let the buyer beware. Kind of back to Windows tools at this point. Anyone here run sysinternal suite? Most of you do, good. I won't pull it up. Someone said, why do I have this on the slide deck? I'm going, because I keep going to clients who do not run sysinternals. Again, with that Aunt Sally or Uncle Joe scenario, they have things running. You can use Process Explorer, which is like Task Manager on steroids. It has auto runs. You buy a new computer with a whole bunch of crapware installed on it, and how do you get it stopped from automatically starting? Run auto runs. Mark Rusinovich, I think, is here at this conference. If you have not seen his video on malware hunting with sysinternals, I highly recommend it. He's a fantastic speaker on how to use it. One of the other cool tools, too, if you're ever wondering how do you zoom in, this is actually Zoom It from sysinternals. They also have a tool called Desktops. Lots of fun little extra tools that should be default with Windows, but is not. God mode, this is just an Easter egg within Windows. Puts everything within the control panel within one folder. So instead of trying to search through the control panel, where do I find network settings? You can just put it into one folder called God mode. You just have to type that in. I just keep this in a text file. And then you have a little icon on your desktop. I actually think, do I have it running? I thought I had it running, but I don't. Power toys, I need to show you this. You know on Windows, so this is Windows only, you're trying to remember all the different Windows key shortcuts, and you're going, I can't remember them all. Well, with power toys installed, you just hold down the Windows key, and it shows you all of the shortcuts. Free off of GitHub from Microsoft. There are actually three different main tools they have. They have one called Fancy Zones. You hold Shift, and you can go into different zones on your desktop. They have Power Rename, so you need to rename like 100 different files all at once instead of renaming them individually. They have a Power Toys tool to do that for you. PowerShell. Instead of using the command prompt, run things using PowerShell. It's up to PowerShell 6. PowerShell is freely available, again, open source. It's that combination between the old command prompt from Windows and Linux. You can script with it and really use it to automate it. If you're working with Windows sysadmins, they use PowerShell quite extensively to automate. As I mentioned earlier, we are converging between Linux and Windows. So let me show you how easy, once you have it installed, how easy it is to use. So you just pull up the File Explorer. That's all I have. I have it on my C drive. Go in here, and if you just type the word bash, boom, Linux on Windows. Who would have guessed, right? So if you have a Linux geek and you want to be able to grep a file, use find and grep. Grep is still very powerful. Wireshark, many of you now are aware of Wireshark. You should be. It's the network admin tool. If you're trying to troubleshoot on your network, make sure you're running Wireshark. If you're teaching networking to someone or you're trying to learn more about networking, pull up Wireshark. You can see the TCP/IP handshake right in the middle of it as you're doing it. There's lots of great tutorials on Wireshark out there. This is one of the mandatory tools that I use with my students as well. Now, this is brand new tools I have added since last year because some people were asking me about network administration and monitoring. So whether it's Zeek or Selks, I do want to pull up some of the free tools from Active Countermeasures. Why did you just jump ahead? Where am I? There we go. Oh, this is the sysinternal suite, PowerShell. So from Active Countermeasures, I took part in they had a free training, I think it was across a Saturday with Black Hills Security, where they talked about a lot of these tools for threat analysis. They have their ADHD, Active Defense, they call it Harbinger distribution. But basically what these tools do is allows you to perform an IDS or SIM within your network. So let's just say you have a small infrastructure and you don't want to or can't pay for a larger network management tool, these may just do the trick for you, between that or Zeek and Selks. SolarWinds provides free ones, they're also paid for, so I just kind of leave this in here just to kind of keep it there. Night is really good for home use. So if you need to stay up to date on patching or I get a brand new system, friend asked me to install it and I won't need to install all of their apps for them, you can do a lot of it automated through Night. Who here is completely up to date with patching? That's what I thought. Whether it's on our mobile device or within our infrastructures, right? This is a common challenge. It's like making sure we stay up to date with our oil change. There are free tools or low-cost tools. So Chocolaty and Batch Patch, I've played with. They do have paid-for versions to use within an organization. The one I want to show is Snipe. It is open source, REST API. Cloud-based updating, particularly if you have an infrastructure or you have people that get off of your base network. This is a common problem, right? Where you have those traveling salespeople who never get to the home office to get updated. So I'm beginning to play with this tool to be able to see if we can use this to update them. Just do it completely over the internet. So snipe it. Any Snipe It fans out there? No, good. Okay, so one, I'm curious to hear from you. I just saw a thumbs up. And again, that's the power of these types of conferences, to hear from them. Others, what you think. Open source intelligence, kind of bouncing back to social engineering a little bit here. Asint, how do we pull information? We all leak privacy data all the time, everywhere. How do we pull it all off of the different social networks? How do I know what information an organization is leaking? Well, Ian Barwise created this really cool chart. I want to pull up his actual whole article here. And I love his first line. Whoa, slow your roll, cowboy. Before we can get to the shell popping, make sexy time. Okay, laugh. Hacking adventures. Start by knowing what is right in front of you as far as what information is already out there on a website. Can you pull off of the cache from Google? Because Google is like a time machine, right? Or you can go to archive.org for their time machine. Gathering as much information. Here's the OSINT process. OSINT is definitely one of the buzzwords I hear for 2020, and I think it's really kind of cool. As a prior military intelligence officer, I pull a lot of my information just off of stuff that people are putting out there anyway. This has a nice list of different tools, everything from Google searching and dorking, Whois lookups. Again, don't discount this. PowerShell, a whole bunch of fun ones. Let me show you a quick OSINT tool. This is the OSINT framework. Let me see if I can't make this a little bit bigger. There we go. So you start out, say I want to find people by usernames. You go to the username search. Username, username search. And then I can go to name check. And when I clicked on name check, I'm like, hey, cool, instant username search. I'm just starting up a company called Cyber AAA. So where has that name been taken and where is it available? Bingo, now I have a nice list of everywhere I need to create this ID. So this one is really kind of fun from IP addresses. Just the way they list it, you know, put in IPv4 or 6, telephone numbers, dating. Boy, this really gets creepy in a hurry, right? Geolocation. I forgot to warn you, some of these websites are rabbit hole sites. You know, like Alice in Wonderland, once you dump down the rabbit hole, you're going to be there for a number of hours. So you begin to just begin to play. In fact, I'm going to back up. This is one. It's the rabbit hole site for me. I showed this one early on. This is The Art of Hacking, H4CKER. And I just got reintroduced to it. And I'm like, yeah, spending forever. Then I realized, hey, there's a whole what the hack. So if you're trying to teach hacking to others, we have a whole lot of lists right there. So OSINT tools. Multigo also can be used to pull information. I want to show Shodan, though. I put in my university. Go hack yourself, right? So I put in their host name. You do need an account for Shodan. They do give a limited number of searches for free. If you're part of an education organization, you can get a more extended license. This just tells me what my university is leaking on the internet. So the fun question I'll ask, okay, who provides internet service for my university? And you will see that it's Cox. I found that different operating systems my university is run, they're running IIS, that we have PeopleSoft. I've used this to find all sorts of fun information about my clients, because my clients don't always know the information that they leak. What I do is I help people become aware. I provide them with those answers. So that's the OSINT tools. I covered a lot of these. Again, I mentioned that these are, the power of this talk is really this list. A Spiderfoot is really fun to run. What I found is particularly older organizations, government organizations, have a lot of old websites out there. They have a lot of old documents out on their websites that are hidden. They just don't longer point to them, but they're still there, and they could still be spidered. So that's what Spiderfoot does, is it spiders different websites that you pointed at just to see what is still there. And they realized that they had old client documents out on their website publicly available. All I did was show them what really anyone could find through open source. Similar tool to Shodan is Census. on servers and devices. You'll find people that'll use this too. I recommend running Shodan against your home network to see what the internet knows about all of your IoT devices. Can they see that camera you have above your garage or your thermostat? What can be seen with it? And then there are the different distributions. These are Linux distributions. I think many are already familiar with the Kali. Parrots is another one I've used. Tails is good for privacy. So if you're wanting to ensure some privacy, I'll spin up a Linux Tails environment for it. And then social engineering toolkit, run your own phishing tests. A lot of these I talked about in the past. I want to kind of jump ahead to a few more of the newer tools and then see if I have a minute or two for questions. I include Nessus. I keep Nessus in here, even though it's a Tenable product, because Nessus has been around for, what, 25 years. It's still a tool we can use for vulnerability testing within an environment. I'll do it for nonprofits or my home. Again, if you're doing this as part of a for-profit, you have to look at the for-profit license. And then if you really want to geek out, go pull up OpenVAS. That's trusted. OpenVAS, vulnerability assessments. Another point on the buyer, let the buyer beware with this, is that you need to make sure you have someone who understands how to not only run it, making sure that it's run in a safe manner, because I've seen organizations take down their network inadvertently running Nessus, running OpenVAS. So run it on a test network, but also you need to know how to read the results. And then there's the whole application security side. Earlier I mentioned OWASP. Who here runs OWASP Zap against your applications? A few, okay. So there's two parts of application development testing. There's dynamic scanning and there's static scanning. Zap is more of a dynamic, so it's looking at it being run almost interactively. Static scanner actually will look at the code itself and find known vulnerabilities within application code, whether it's Java, Python, C, C Sharp, etc. Burp Suite, I've learned, is really what a lot of the application security testers use. It is a paid-for product, though. Heads up on that. I've used Infection Monkey for clients in the past as well, when they want to understand and know that their security. Oop. This is how I know I need to be almost done with my talk when my battery's about ready to die, because I forgot to plug in. The Hive. So say you need to do incident response. There's SANSIF, there's numerous tools out there. I like the Hive because it automates a lot of your incident response process. All in one. So if you have not played, or if you need to worry about incident response, malware, let's see, I'm gonna jump ahead. Oh, VirusTotal. I'm often asked, are you ever asked, what AV do you run? Again, you can get into a religious battle. I stay out of that. I just point people to the list, whether PC Magazine, Tom's Guide. The important part of this, make sure you let people know about VirusTotal. You get that weird URL, you want to make sure it's okay. You can put it into VirusTotal. Same thing with that file. So I'm going to all send you a file today with my presentation slides. Run it against VirusTotal. Share VirusTotal with others. Password vaults. Make sure you keep a secure vault of your passwords. Do you store them in the browser? I do store some in browsers. Usually they're not the ones I care about otherwise. Actually, I use a combination between LastPass and KeePass at this point. I actually posted a YouTube video on this one. Someone says, hey, I need you to send me a file. And I want to make sure that file is encrypted over the internet. How do I do that? You can use 7-Zip. 7-Zip is another oldie but goodie tool that uses AES 256 encryption. It is password-based, so don't send the password along with the file. I still see people do that. But it's really simple, right? I'll just call them up and say, I'm sending you the file. You could also use the password security within Word. Is it perfect? No. But is it good enough? Yes. Is it cheap? Yes. Why do we keep using passwords? Because they're cheap and easy to use. So just deal with it. Setting up your own home lab, I need to give a shout out for using Raspberry Pi, going to Hack 5, getting a pineapple Wi-Fi, or some of their other cool tools. How many have a Raspberry Pi? So most, yep, use it to create your own home lab. Last topic, actually two more topics, real quick. One, I'll get clients. They'll say, hey Ron, I need help developing a disaster recovery plan. Can you help write one for me? I just pull up ready.gov. FEMA actually has a whole suite of tools for creating disaster recovery plans. And you just plug in your information about your organization and it will spit out a disaster recovery plan you can then use as a template. It includes tools, you can see this here, for business continuity trainer, you see the plan generator, conducting your own exercises. So if you need to conduct your own DR test exercise, tabletop. This one is actually really important. This gets kind of that foot stomp. If you hear of a small, medium business that gets hit with ransomware, business email compromise, what have you, please tell them about ic3.gov. And it is .gov. I keep wanting to type in .org. That does not work. They need to buy that. FBI's Internet Crimes Complaint Center, they just published their report from 2019. And you can see the financial damage cybercrime is causing throughout the United States. So what happens? If I steal a dollar from everybody right now in this room, you're all going, oh, it's just a buck. He was pretty good. He kind of earns it, right? You don't think much about it. But then that'll show up on the radar that I just got, $400, right? That's why IC3.gov is so important. Even the little cyber crime should be reported. This way the FBI can gather their statistics and maybe see that critical mass. Who else to contact? Your police, insurance company, bank. Please go out and help your local businesses. Just provide them with this information. I'm not saying you provide any free service to them. Let them know when you get into trouble, there are organizations out there that can help. We do want to help. I hate hearing those stories. I'm often asked, as an educator, where do you go to learn more? Here's a number of the different sites with information on different types of education for certification, whether it's Security Plus, CYSA, CISSP, CISM. Oops. And I forgot to plug in. The last site was the Cybersecurity Canon, currently sponsored by Palo Alto Networks. And by the way, folks, I still have homework for you. So what I want you to do as you're walking out, make sure you find a couple of the tools that are out there. That's why I love doing this. And actually, if you could go ahead and switch to the regular laptop, I can actually switch to this, back to this. And switch ahead. What questions do you have for me? Are there any other tools that you are familiar with that I did not mention? If you do, please, you can come up to the mic, or if not, because I think we have 2 minutes, go back to the apply slide. Oh, we do have one. Hey, yes. Ron,
thanks for the great talk. You haven't mentioned anything on PGP, GPG-based tools. What is yours?
Oh, so the question was about PGP. Those encryption, the GPG types of tools. You're right, that's another really oldie but goodie. The problem with PGP, it has such an interesting history associated with it from when Phil Zimmerman wrote it and got almost put in jail for it to now. I haven't really kept up to date. And plus, what I look for is tools that can be used by common small medium businesses. And when I begin to talk about sharing keys, their eyes glaze over. It's a good tool that could potentially be used. Question is how much user training is associated with it, to get standard users to use it. So, that answer your question?
Yes, thanks.
Good. at this point, I will just wrap up. Please share your tools, connect with me on LinkedIn and through Twitter. Go out there, help others be safe. Oh, and it looks like we have one more.
Well,
if you have a quick tool.
Not exactly a question, but I do have a tool.
If you're leaving, you might want to listen in. This is often where I learn the top ones.
So if you're interested in mobile malware forensics, a good Linux distribution is Santoku. It has a bunch of tools already pre-built into the operating system that will allow you to just plug in any phone that you might think is infected with malware and be able to analyze all that malware.
So for malware analysis, and what's the name of that again?
Santoku.
Okay. So connect with me. I want to learn more about that one. That sounds fascinating. So thank you all very much. Enjoy the rest of your time here. Go out and be safe.